It's like living your life on credit cards and keeping your fingers crossed. That's exactly what the U.S. Senate has done for 3 years. They've borrowed trillions of dollars without a blueprint, and they just hoped for the best.
If you did that with your own money, you'd also end up in big debt and big trouble. That's why there's a new bill to punish Congress for failing to pass a budget. It's a hit with the public. But will lawmakers really vote for it? John Jessup has more.
These days on Capitol Hill, about the only predictable thing is Congress's inability to pass a budget on time. We stand at more than 1,000 days and counting since the Senate even passed a budget, and 14 years since Congress acted on time.
The hearing will come to order.
If Congress is not doing the basics, like, for example, providing a budget for the government, then that is a bad thing.
Bill Galston of the group No Labels blames partisanship for much of the problem.
The polarization between the two political parties is as sharp and complete as it has been for more than 100 years, since the 1890s. And the polarization is producing a fair amount of gridlock.
His group backs the No Budget, No Pay Act, which would dock lawmakers' pay if they don't pass a budget. Two lawmakers, a Republican senator and a Democratic congressman, are co-sponsoring the bill.
Now, the idea is nothing new. Just last month, Georgia Congressman Paul Brown introduced what's called the Budget or Bust Act. It simply would withhold lawmakers' pay until they get the job done. No Budget, No Pay takes it a step further. It literally would cut lawmakers off until they produce a budget and with no retroactive pay.
A No Labels poll shows 88% of Americans favor the measure.
It polls very well. It's almost a twofer for the voters. You get a budget on time, you get a shot at Congress.
Some lawmakers, like Republican Susan Collins, see the bill as unfair. They say, why hurt the rank and file when it's the leadership that should bear the responsibility?
The power to negotiate a budget through a committee and bring it up for a vote on the Senate floor is not equally shared by all members.
But Congress's record low popularity could cause lawmakers to think twice before dismissing the measure.
I talked to a member of Congress, a veteran member, who said, you know, Bill, if this piece of legislation ever gets to the floor, it'll pass overwhelmingly because nobody will dare to vote against it.
John Jessup, CBN News, Capitol Hill.
You know that commercial about the man that's slipping, he's snipping his hedge, and his friend says, what's your plan for retirement? He says, well, gazillions. Well, how are you going to get it? Well, I'm just going to hope and throw things at it and hope for a gazillion. Well, I think the Congress is spending gazillions, and they don't know where they're going with it. It's terrible. What no members want to go on record as saying, well, I oppose this or I favor that, or I'll cut this or I'll cut the other, because they figure there's some group out there that'll vote against them. That isn't courage, and we don't have it, but we've got such intense partisanship that is hurting our nation. So what are they going to do? Well, they might pass that. We'll see. Well, Lee Webb has the rest of our top stories in the CBN newsroom. Lee?
Pat, President Obama has drawn a major line in the sand, saying he now supports gay marriage. And the president is using the Bible to defend his position. But evangelical leaders, including one of the president's spiritual advisors, say they disagree with his reasoning. Heather Sells has the latest.
Just 8 years ago, the president said in a speech that as a Christian, he believed in traditional marriage. But in an interview with Good Morning America's Robin Roberts, Obama said his faith had helped him and Mrs. Obama to form their new position.
We're both practicing Christians, and obviously this position may be considered to put us at odds with the views of others, but you know, when we think about our faith, the thing, you know, at root that we think about is not only Christ sacrificing himself on our behalf, but it's also the golden rule, you know, treat others the way you'd want to be treated.
The president's own spiritual advisor, the Reverend Joel Hunter of Florida, says he's disappointed and already told the president he disagrees with his interpretation of the Bible. The head of the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops says Obama's remarks undermine the institution of marriage. And the president of the Southern Baptist Convention predicts that voters will hold Obama accountable for a calculated, politically expedient decision that completely ignores the biblical foundation of marriage. In Maryland, Bishop Harry Jackson agreed.
I was disappointed because I think this really needs to be something that people think about and not just kind of manipulated, if you would, by PR.
How this announcement will play politically is still unclear. GOP strategist Ralph Reed predicts it will fuel evangelical turnout this fall, and Republican frontrunner Mitt Romney was quick to respond to the president on the campaign trail Tuesday.
Marriage itself is a relationship between a man and a woman.
A recent Pew poll shows just 28% of registered voters say gay marriage will be very important to their vote. Still, that same poll shows 1 in 3 Southern swing voters are strongly opposed to gay marriage. And nationwide, there is still great support for traditional marriage. 31 states, including North Carolina on Tuesday, have approved traditional marriage amendments to their state constitutions. And so far, the president still says it's up to individual states to decide how to handle the issue. Heather Sell, CBN News.
Pat, what do you think the political fallout will be from this?
I think it's going to be very strong. The president has decided he's going to cater to a small group of wealthy supporters. He's going to a fundraiser at George Clooney's house that's expected to gain him $15 million, plus a whole lot more. So the Hollywood crowd is 100% in favor of gay marriage. So he's catering to them. In the Keystone Pipeline case, he's going against organized labor, the Steelworkers Union, and he's going in favor of the extreme environmentalists. In each instance, you find him deciding his core constituency is a tiny segment of the population, and he's going to cater to them. And that's what's happened. You see it over and over again. He's captive to these groups. So maybe he's not a captive, maybe he's part of it. But nevertheless, what's going to happen is he's insulting the workers. You know, a guy in prison in West Virginia, he was a convict, almost polled as much in a Democratic primary as Obama did in West Virginia. That's amazing, but that's what's true. So the coal miners are against him. The steel workers are coming against him. Now, he's alienated the Catholics when he was going to say you have to provide contraceptive services for your schools and institutions, et cetera. So he got them mad. Now, he's insulted all those in the Hispanic community who are very strong for traditional marriage. Plus, again, he's insulted the Catholic Church. This time, he's brought in the Southern Baptist. And all along the way, he is alienating major segments who are key in pivotal states. When he's only up over Romney in a percentage point or so in these swing states, it wouldn't take many people to shift to cause a defeat. And he's carefully going down the list. He's insulted the money people, the bankers, the job creators, manufacturers, you name it. He's just finding enemies everywhere. And before long, those enemies are going to say, well, we don't want you. You're not one of us. And young people are not as enthusiastic. He was the great change agent who was the Messiah coming in on a white horse. He isn't that anymore. He's a failed president. So what's going to happen? I think this is one more sign that he really doesn't think he's going to win the next election, but he's going to cater to those who are his core friends and supporters, however radical they may be. Lee?
Pat, the House of Representatives is taking steps now to protect members of the military who object to homosexuality based on religious or moral grounds. The House Armed Services Committee has approved conscience protections for all members of the armed forces, including chaplains. The measure would prevent discrimination against those who hold traditional values on sexuality.
There's pressure on them in terms of advancement. If you don't do what you're supposed to do, then you won't get a promotion, or you won't be allowed to do this, or you get a bad fitness report. So this is one of those things so that people can be faithful to the group that they came from, and it allows them, in a sense, an umbrella of protection.
Lawmakers also approved a ban on using military facilities for same-sex marriage ceremonies. Both amendments are wrapped up in next year's Pentagon budget.
and the House will likely vote on that funding bill next week. FBI Director Robert Mueller says al-Qaeda in Yemen is still a significant threat. The CIA broke up an al-Qaeda bomb plot this week. Still, Mueller told members of Congress, U.S. remains vigilant.
Let me begin with the threat from terrorism, which remains our top priority. Al-Qaeda affiliates, especially al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, represent the top counterterrorism threat to the nation.
Al-Qaeda's best bomb maker is still at large, and the U.S. believes he's building a variety of devices to bypass airport security, including bombs implanted in cameras, computers, and even pets. Meanwhile, new details are emerging on the damage done to al-Qaeda by that intelligence operation. It not only gave the USA a look at al-Qaeda's latest bomb, it also led to last weekend's drone strike that killed a top al-Qaeda figure. And today, an airstrike in Yemen killed another five al-Qaeda terrorists. Medicare gave billions of dollars to pharmacies with questionable billings. A new government report found that in 2009, the program paid $5.6 billion to pharmacies with suspicious activities. For example, a Kansas drugstore submitted 2,000 prescriptions for just two patients. The report found that 2,600 pharmacies have questionable billing practices. That's only 4% of the nation's pharmacies, but losses add up because the typical pharmacy bills Medicare about $1 million a year. And yes, Pat, that is real money.
You know, it's so incredible when Congressman Ryan puts out a budget to restrain the expansion of government, and to, it cuts back the growth rate of spending. It doesn't cut spending, it cuts back the growth rate. The president comes out and says that's, quote, social Darwinism, whatever in the world that means. But in any event, he is opposed to anything that smacks of fiscal discipline. We've got waste, we've got duplication, we've got incredible fraud going on. He doesn't want to do anything to stop it. And the Congress is saying we've got to stop it. The American people say we cannot continue this huge outflow of funds to these bogus projects. We can't do it. But the president won't come out. He won't come out with a budget that's realistic. And the Senate won't have a budget. And nobody seems to want to cut back on waste and fraud.
The number of international adoptions is at its lowest point in nearly 15 years, dropping by about 50%. A researcher at Britain's Newcastle University says the number of orphans worldwide being adopted by foreign parents dropped to about 25,000 last year. That's down from a high of 45,000 in 2004. Adoption advocates say the drop is due to the poor global economy, efforts by countries to place more children with domestic families, and a crackdown on baby selling. The Iranian pastor jailed for his faith has written a public letter to fellow Christian believers. It reads in part, "I try to be humble and obedient to those who are in power and pray for them to rule the country according to the will of God." Pastor Youssef Nardar Khani says he's thankful for the peaceful Christian and humanitarian efforts seeking his freedom, but he believes protests like Quran burnings cause more stress and trouble. Well, you can read Pastor Youssef's entire letter as well as all the latest headlines at our website at cbnnews.com.